Let me call the 30th meeting of Rotary Cantonment to order. And let me ask for a moment of silence for world peace and COVID deaths, please. Can we all stand up for... Nice to see Rotarians and Charming Ants this evening on a wonderful event, specially curated by our president-elect and his team. And welcome, everyone. May I invite the speaker to be invited on to come over to the stage. Can somebody escort her, please? Speaker this evening is none other than our Rekha Rao, who thank you so much. May I invite Gargi to make her announcement? Do we have any guests here today? Other than... Yeah. Yeah.
Right. 21st January, that is today. Jasbir and Harpreet. Priti. Harpreet is so difficult to call you Harpreet. Celebrate their wedding anniversary. So, best wishes to both of them.
Can you kindly come up? Please.
On 23rd of January, Ramesh Kumar and Sheila, they celebrate their wedding anniversary. Our best wishes to them.
But if you're watching, Ramesh.
He should be there.
Yeah.
24th January, Prashant Nair. Prashant is also not here today. Okay. Many happy returns of the day, Prashant.
Prashant.
And on 25th of January, and Anita Agrawal celebrates her birthday. So best wishes to her. She's also not here. Next is our committee meetings. On 23rd, Vocational Committee is going to have their monthly committee meeting. And director has already circulated the details. Now there is a slight change in our international committee meeting, which was originally scheduled for 22nd. This is rescheduled for 29th, I think. Shabir, it's 29th, right? Yeah. So 29th. So in due course, Shabir will be circulating all the details. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Gargi. We have our ICJF, and the governor has personally requested me to communicate to each one of our members. We have taken 15 passes, so we make sure that we all attend, at least get our minimum number of 15 to attend this ICJF. I have requested the current vocational service committee members and the incoming vocational service committee members, along with the director Venkat, to participate in the ICJF. This is on Saturday the 30th after 4 p.m., starting at 4 p.m., followed by, I think, dinner and all that. So the venue and other details will be communicated. You can also log in for this ICJF online, so virtual. So that's also available now. Some of the takeaways we've had on the GOV is that the district governor was quite pleased with some of our actions and activities which we had centered around in the forestation, in the international, as well as the ones which we have done in the healthcare when he came to inaugurate the hematology analyzer in Kidwai. So he has requested the director to try and see and evaluate if we can have a blood bank, which we can put it up in Kidwai, with us being the lead club. And a few other clubs, he's made sure that he promised to make sure that they will join us in this initiative. And this is the initiative for the South Bangalore blood bank, because he feels that the TTK blood bank, Rotary blood bank, is pretty much over capacity. And he feels that the blood bank should be spread out so that people can be encouraged more to donate. So we said, fine, we will take this initiative up. So we're working on this project with myself and Samir, are broadly trying to put together some numbers and we're trying to see how we can raise money for this. That's a separate activity altogether. But the fact is that we wanted to make sure that there is clarity available from the Kidwai side also as to what they're giving us. They're willing to give us land and building, so which is something which is a good thing which is coming up. So that's kind of going to be one of the big projects which is going to happen. Maybe, I don't know whether it can definitely happen by this year. So we will try and keep Vinod in the loop to see how much he would like to participate in that particular project, to see how we can take that to the next steps. Coming back to the evening. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Yes, I have already sent a notice that our 28th meeting, that is next Thursday's meeting, is preponed to 26th, that's Tuesday, and it's Republic Day. So we are going to have a program here, and also vocational committee is having their vocational award function here. And the agenda and all the details I'll be circulating, say, in a day or so. And that's one thing I just wanted to mention. Thank you.
Thank you, Varki. May I now invite Jasbir, 7:40, to take over the proceedings for the evening.
President, Speaker, Secretary, fellow Rotarians, and guests. Art meets charity. These three words are going to describe this evening's program. And I must say, premeditatedly, a very, very interesting program unfolding before you this evening. Of course, we would have had many more people here, would have been better, but I'm sure our friends online can participate virtually in this meeting. We are going to start off with a very interesting person addressing us, a very senior artist in her own right, Rekha Rao. She's going to be introduced shortly. We are going to be followed by none other than Anand Biraj Kalyan, talking about her journey as an artist. In fact, when I asked Biraj what made you take up an artist and be a painter, She said, one night, this message flashed across her eyes and said that, thou shalt do unto canvas as thou dost unto flesh. So she decided to drop her scalpel and pick up a paintbrush. I'm sure she's got a lot to say about the fact that though she started off as an artist, probably for exhibiting her talents and whatever she could do, it turned out that in a blessing that she also decided to make her art into a charitable cause for the club in terms of a project, which again is going to be introduced shortly. It's called a project SHE, Self-Help Education. And this is for the female child. We are going to have, first of all, Rotarian Sushila, who is going to introduce very briefly Project SHE to all of you, and then the program will follow. Sushila, if you're online, please take over now.
Hi, are you able to hear me? Okay, so, you know, I just want to start with a little story. A girl called Neelavva came to stay with us to look after my mother. And she's from a village near Aihole. She, you know, her father is a small-time farmer there. She was doing her BCom there when the family decided the only way they could survive was if the mother moved to Bangalore and tried to do something about, you know, earning some more money. So the mother moved. She brought her two daughters and a son. The son was completely disinterested in education, an older son. So he was completely disinterested in education. So he never went beyond the 8th standard. But here was Neelavva, who had enrolled for her BCom, really wanted to do her BCom and become something. And she was uprooted. And because they came to Bangalore, there was no way but to send her to work. So she's working and she has to put her younger sister through school. And after that, maybe she could continue with her BCom and then her dreams. The story of Neelavva is repeated time and time again across the length and breadth of India. Our statistics in terms of the primary school enrollments is very good. The girls are there. But as we progress through secondary school and then higher secondary school, there is an extremely high level of dropout. And then college, well, it's appalling. So we in Rotary Bangalore Cantonment decided to do something about it. For years, we've been supporting school education of both school and college students through our scholarship scheme. We thought that we will focus on the girl child and help girls realize their dreams and aspirations. So Project SHE, which is Support Her Education, this year will focus on supporting and giving scholarships to girls in the 9th, 10th, and then college. So we are actually going to actively seek out girls who fall into this category, who have those dreams and aspirations, who are good and but do not have the means, and help them realize those dreams. So that's what Project SHE is about. The other thing is, this is led by the ladies of RCBC. That's all of us, Rotarian ladies, as well as wives of the other Rotarians, remaining Rotarians. So we are going to be the ones who are leading this project. And why is that important? It's a project of the club, so it belongs to all of us, but it's led by the ladies. Why that is important is because in addition to the usual facilities that we would provide any scholarship holder, which is things like mentorship, this year we've allocated 24 mentors to 36 scholars from standard 10th and up. And nine of those mentors are ladies of RCBC. So we are going to continue the mentorship program, of course, but we are also going to provide inputs that are very specific to girls. Things like health, personal health, both mental and physical. Things like the importance of financial planning. Things like assertiveness, communication. How do you dream of something and make sure you get there? How do you inspire these girls so that they stay with it and do not get pushed out because of other family priorities or societal pressures. So, you know, those are the kind of inputs that we are going to provide in addition to the scholarship. This is very exciting, obviously. And I really hope all of us will participate and we'll get many, many more people to join hands with us. So thank you for listening and just an invitation to join the project.
Thank you, Sushila, for a very clear and lucid description of she. Very importantly, though, as she rightly mentioned, this project is going to be spearheaded by the ladies, which includes the ants and lady members. If they are going to be the infantry, the men have to be the armored squad. We can't just leave them alone. We are going to be as much involved in this project as all of them in every which way that we can. We now have and Rekha Shivdev coming up and briefly introducing our speaker and chief guest for this evening, Rekha Rao.
Good evening, everybody. Rotary President, Rotarian Ravi Narasimhan, dear aunts, energetic Rotarians, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. To have been given this pleasant task of introducing our chief guest of this evening, Mrs. Rekha Rao, is indeed an honor. It's a happy coincidence that she happens to be my namesake, but I guess that's where the similarity ends. Although she has been associated with Rotary Cantonment for nearly a decade now, perhaps not many of us have known of her lineage, talent, her accomplishments, and her multifaceted personality. She is the daughter of the renowned artist Padma Bhushan K.K. Hebbar, and she herself is an accomplished artist. Born in 1947, she grew up in an artistic and politically charged environment that shaped her art practice to a large extent. Her artistic journey began at the age of 4. Her father believed that the formal art education would hamper her individuality and creative expression and encouraged her to study Indian history. Mrs. Rekha's first art exhibition was held in the year 1969 at Jahangir Art Gallery in Mumbai. She has been a practicing contemporary artist since then and has participated in major exhibitions in India and abroad. She has participated in several national and international art camps and workshops. Her works have been showcased at NGMA, Mumbai and Bangalore, National Museum of Singapore, and the Fukuoka Museum at Japan. Many of her works have gone under the hammer and decorate the walls of the galleries of corporate offices and private collectors in India and abroad. Widely traveled, she is a recipient of several awards, including the Suvarna Karnataka Rajyotsava Award. In 2003, she moved to Bangalore and has lived here since. As an extension of being an artist, she is keenly interested in making a change in the society through her art. She has worked with slum children in Mumbai, Child Rights and You, Concern India, Cancer Society of India, and others. She is also a trustee of K.K. Hebbar Art Foundation, which supports deserving artists and art projects. Her list of accomplishments are longer, but the time is too short to list them here today. Closer home, she, along with her late husband, I.M. Rao, started Mali Foundation, an NGO, situated inside the Navajivanalaya Trust Complex. It was established to help underprivileged girls and economically backward women to sustain themselves by providing them with training in different skills. Mrs. Rekha Rao is the main trustee looking after the activities at Mali Foundation. Our club run occasional training programs, the beautician's course, tailoring and embroidery, and other women empowerment programs and projects are held in association with the Mali Foundation and are very well supported and encouraged by her. Our own dear Anne Biraj, Dr. Biraj, has passionately created art and magnanimously donated for a cause to raise funds for Project She. Indeed, we could not have had a more befitting chief guest this evening, since today is a celebration of art and philanthropy. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to present to you Mrs. Rekha Hebbar Rao.
Our chief guest will be talking for about 15 to 18 minutes about her art and her journey. And we have requested her to leave a few minutes in the end for question and answers from the audience.
Good evening, everyone. I'm indeed very happy to be here this evening, more so because we've had a long association with Rotary Cantonment for the past eight years, I think, and it has always been the president and the other, what you call, holders of official who have met, I have met at the Mali shelter. And this is a good occasion for me to meet and also know about other activities that you do it here. Basically, Mali Shelter was founded in 2006 in Bangalore by Semicron International, which is in Nuremberg, and my husband's company, Monolithic Devices and Electronics Private Limited in Mumbai. This was part of our corporate CSR project. And earlier I've done a lot of work in Bombay, which has already mentioned. So when we came here, we were looking for a place and it was so hard to rent a place because when they said it was an orphanage or when it was, they were not willing to give us any place. So we had to look out. And I must, even today, I thank Dr. Bagiltaya for this because he so generously offered us 1 acre of plot at Varthur, Navajivana Society. Now this place was given to Dr. Bagiltaya 35 years ago for rehabilitation of leprosy patients. But when leprosy was, I suppose it's almost now eradicated. And so the space was there and he thought we should make good use of it. So part of it went to Karuna Shraya, which is a cancer rehabilitation center. And the other one part of it went to Shankara Eye Hospital, which is one of the biggest hospitals in Bangalore. And we got a tiny little place. We were happy with it. And that's where we started building. And it was Semicron who came forward to lend us the support. Even today, they are the main supporters. We do not take any donation from anyone. I mean, government. Not others are welcome. So this whole attitude of being able to help society, even whatever way we can, even if it's a small little drop in the ocean, I think it's worth it. It makes us more happy to have given something to the society back. It may not be much. But here again, I thank Rotarians, Cantonment, and also we have another organization called APSA. They have about 10 right now 10, but usually it's about 30-35 students who we have dormitory facilities there, who live there, and they are trained, just as like you were talking about now. And then they are given some kind of a vocational training by which they can get gainfully employed. And later on, we keep them for a little while longer till they find their feet. And then, of course, they have to face the big wide world. They go out and the next batch comes in. In the meantime, we also have attached ourselves to Vidya organization, which was started in Delhi by Rashmi Mishra and her husband, Ashok Mishra. Ashok was the dean of IIT Delhi and IIT Mumbai. And she has now, I think, about 29 centers in India, and all for the empowerment of women. So I thought this was the right place. You know, I had the space, I had the whole floor, and they're doing excellent job too. So now in this pandemic year, we could hardly do much, and I'm hoping that we'll come again together. and think out of some new ways by which we can reach out to people, not only education, as I said, as we spoke a few minutes ago, but how to change the mindset of the women and the men. So all other education that we do goes down the drain once they leave the campus. It is of no use. We have found that unless we are able to channelize whatever they have learned in the right direction, it's not going to pay us. We'll have to talk about that. We have to see how we can do that. We had corporate people coming there on weekends or whenever they had time and spending time with these girls to train them, kind of train them in the sense to polish them, because they don't know how to go about. They may know a little bit of English and then they say, I know English. It's not important they know English, but they know how to communicate, whatever it is. So these things have been happening at Mali Foundation, Mali Shelter, and we have to increase that. I'm sure many of you here and many of you who are listening can offer their time whenever they can, come and meet us and talk to the girls, and the doctors among you can come and help, just check up the girls, and they need a lot of counseling. That's what we need now. Because already they are battered with all sort of problems, children at home, drunken husbands and other things. So all these need to be ironed out in a very smooth and understanding way. And therefore, I wish all of you at some time or another, give us some time to Mali Shelter. Now coming to paintings, I'm very happy that these works will be sold, and the work again goes back to Girl Child because she needs it more than anyone else. This whole process of introducing art to the public through charitable way was started in Mumbai years back by the Times of India. You know what they did? They got the works of some well-known artists and they hung it at the Victoria Railway Station on hanging from the roof so that nobody can touch it. It was there hanging. So the boot polish wala or the vendor, everyone was so happy to see a work of art. They would go and sit under it and do their work. And that is how art came to the public, not in Jahangir Art Gallery, not through private galleries, where the audience is very limited. We can't take art that way. Same here, if the art is, how do we show it to more people? Now, going on the webinars and things, you know, how many people really watch webinars? You have a webinar, you have 20 people, 30 people, at the most 50 people. Rest of them are not watching it. And really, art, like music, has to be seen. Music has, you have to listen, but always, you know, a baitak is better than listening to on the record or whatever, you know, music system. The same thing with here. You can say it on the web, but that's a different thing. But when you see the painting and you can feel the tactile qualities, color, line, drawing, that gives you a different feeling. That's what we don't want people to appreciate. That's what we want to introduce art into the lives of people. Now, I have been lucky enough because I've been born into an artist family, grew up with that, and had all the opportunities I needed. I've done a lot of history. I did an MA in art history and all that, but I didn't want to go to the regular academic school, mainly because academic art is a borrowed medium. It's come from after the coming of the British. We never had anything like that, portrait painting or still lives, like the way the British do. We had our own system. We had our own way of looking at portrait, which we used to call Bhava Chitra. You see the person, you see the feelings on the face, and you bring it out in your own way, not by doing three-dimensional portraits, which even a camera can do. So these are the things which I have learned from my father, not through any books or anything, but some things that we have to keep in mind to develop your own style. It has taken me a long time, maybe 40 years now I've been painting, and it has been a slow, gradual way of studying and finding your way. But I've been fortunate. I've traveled widely. I've seen most of the museums, well-known museums in the world, and have been invited, like she said, you know, to many of the camps and international camps and talks. And so that way I'm enriched by what I've seen. And I would like to share that with you today. So I brought a small video of just about 7-8 minutes, and I'd like to show that to you. And I want you to see it, after which you're most welcome to ask me any questions you like. Thank you.
I had an inexplicable need to paint and draw from a very early age. This had to do a lot with my father, K.K. Hebbar. Our house was filled with colors and paints and the smell of turpentine and linseed oil. And it was also a hub for and a meeting place for artists, musicians, dancers, theater people, and writers. This whole atmosphere was such that it lended to my being an artist and growing up loving art all my life. My father did not believe in formal academic art, nor was my temperament suited to it. I had what you would call a guru shishya parampara. He did not correct me, he advised me. But he always guided me and mentored me. My father used to say, the less you teach, the more you learn. And with this in mind, I have gone and continued my art practice through the years. Here I would like to show you how I have tackled or approached issues of the times.
I explore themes that are etched in my memory through the language of colors. Colors become the vehicle for my thoughts. I want my works to live with a paradox. When it seems most descriptive and representational, the illusion of place and situation exists only on a superficial plane. These present works of mine titled The Melancholy State of Happiness speak of my anguish. The concept of conservation and management of ecology existed from ancient times in India. Even during the Mauryan era, there were protected forests where heavy penalties were imposed on violators. But today, I am sad to see a brutally battered environment. Frenzied greed and selfishness is leading us on the path of self-destruction. I became fascinated with birds after reading I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings by Maya Angelou. The relationship between man and bird goes back to early civilizations, including India. Birds played many symbolic roles as harbingers of rain, forecasting weather, messengers, marking time, and foretelling your future. With this in mind, I worked a whole series on canvas, which gave me immense pleasure. My series on cotton and textiles began with my visit to a weaving factory in Aurangabad. It was interesting to watch the nimble fingers of the weavers as they tossed the shuttle left to right, legs moving the paddle. My paintings of that period were called Abravan, running water. And the works revolved around the history of textile, beginning with cotton flower, leading on to carding, combing, and weaving. On my canvases, the narrative was made through threads of color. In my early paintings, I spoke about our marginalized society, mainly child labor and women at work. Born to a free, independent India, I was raised to believe that we will grow into an egalitarian society. But that dream is yet to come true. In prayer, you see a mad vulture dominating the canvas,
commenting on the greedy, selfish nature of man. In 2003, I painted a series of cityscapes on paper, mapping Mumbai. In one work, I spoke of suburban local train track that led to Borivali, where once stood a little unit making Indian flags. Another led to Dharavi, a center where leather goods are made even today. Another map science station and surrounding area, a tribute to incredible Mumbai.
Color has been my vehicle of thought. And over the years, I have tried to approach different subjects which are closer to my heart through the medium of colors. These works that are now exhibited in front of you are testimony to my work.
If there are any questions for the presentation of what our chief guest spoke, we can have a couple of questions and then go on to the next interesting part of the program. Okay, then we can move on to the next part. I am sure all of you will agree that very, very rarely have we seen RHL so inspiring and colorful. It's a wonderful scene when you walked in this evening into RHL and saw what one among us with hidden talents has shown. I won't waste much time. I would like to invite now and bereaved, yet to be vaccinated Kalyan to come on stage and talk about her inspiring journey.
Hello, can you hear me? Yeah. So good evening, everyone who's here and everyone who's joining from home. I'm not new to RCBC. I'm one of you, and many of you have known me over the years. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a medical doctor by profession and training, and that is the only formal training part of my various activities. To be more specific, I'm a fertility specialist working in the field of ART, which stands for Assisted Reproductive Technologies. In common layman terms, I'm an IVF specialist. As I was thinking about what I'm going to say to you today, I was thinking back to my tryst with the Rotary Thursday meeting over the years. I first spoke at a Thursday meeting almost a quarter of a century ago when I was a fairly new Anne. And at that time, I spoke about my subject, about IVF. And my talk was called, When Nature Fails, There's Still Hope. Several years later, when I was older, Lochna asked me to speak at the Thursday meeting, in particular to the Rotarians rather than Anns, about menopause, which was the other end of the spectrum from fertility. A few years later, I repeated that same talk on request from Jyoti and Arvind, who were doing programs for that year. Interspersed in between these over the years have been several Fellowship Thursday performances, mainly involving music of various kinds, ranging from Bollywood to Western to Sanskrit songs to Christmas carols and what have you. And today I'm here to talk to you about my art. So as you can see, it's been quite a journey to art before I even talk about my very brief journey with art. As I mentioned, I'm a doctor by profession, and before 2019, when all of this began, the only art I knew was the art of medicine. The only brush I had with art prior to that was drawing histopathology journals when I was a medical student, and maybe doing some backdrops for Annette's Night or helping Abhi with school projects. I have never been to an art class ever. not even in my school years. So all of this began when I took my father-in-law to an art party in April 2019, which is actually not very long ago at all. A friend and neighbor had started a new venture and was having a session in our clubhouse. So after I paid up and signed him up for it, he got cold feet about going on his own, and so I offered to accompany him. Watching that session sparked my interest. I had no idea whether I was going to be any good at it, but I decided I wanted to try. But I had no paints, no art materials, not even basic poster colors or markers at home because Abhi had long since grown up. So when a few days later they had another session, I decided to enroll myself for it with one request. I wanted to be allowed to do my own thing without having to paint the set piece that everybody else was going to paint. All I wanted was a blank canvas and some paints to see what I could do on my own without any help. They were kind enough to agree and indulge me. And I have a painting in the catalog, if you have seen that, it's also on my website called Intrigue, which was the very first painting I did, which was painted at this session. I enjoyed the whole process so much that I decided I wanted to pursue this. So as soon as I came home, I ordered some paints from Amazon and some basic art supplies, bought a few stretch canvases from the same friend, and dived right in. Over the next 2 or 3 months, this became an all-consuming passion. In the initial months, I tried to do one painting a week, but very soon that pace became difficult to sustain as life happened and other things demanded my time and attention. So I've had stops and starts and long lulls in between. But it was during lockdown when I had no time to even think about painting, let alone actually paint, so buried was I in domesticity, that I realized how much I missed it. So as soon as lockdown got over, I bought some canvases online from whoever was willing to sell and deliver, and there weren't too many people at that time. And since then, I've been trying to paint whenever I can manage to find the time amongst all other responsibilities. So as I did my first few paintings, I was wondering what to do with the paintings collecting at home, which is when I thought about using my paintings to raise funds for a cause. Of course, RCBC became a natural fit the moment this thought occurred to me. But I wanted to build an inventory for it to be a meaningful contribution. So I waited till I had painted about 50 paintings before floating this idea on our RCBC ladies WhatsApp group. I also wanted to create a website to display my paintings. Of course, once again, I had no idea how to go about making a website, but like with everything else in my life, once I decided that I wanted to do it, I started teaching myself how to do it and managed to build my website completely on my own. So when I posted a beta version of the website on our group, Rotarian Sushila was excited about using the paintings as a fundraiser, and we had a few conversations about it before formally putting the idea to the club. Since then, it's taken a couple of months before we have reached to this point today. I was also keen that the funds be used for a project related to women empowerment or children, and that is how Project She was born. Sushila has already talked to you about the project, so I'm not going to elaborate on it further. It's in my life, I've had to reinvent myself time and again as and when life and circumstances demanded it. It's the story of all of us. I think all of us, especially the women, have had to do this. And if I can do it, anyone can. Sometimes we can surprise ourselves if only we have the courage to take the plunge. You may win some, you may lose some, but you never know until you try. I have been very privileged to have had a great education and opportunity in life, which has helped me. So I'm hoping that Project She will similarly help the girl children and equip them with the tools that give them the courage and confidence to chart their own course in life. I'm, of course, very, very new at this, learning as I go along, taking baby steps forward. But I know that when I sit with my paints, the rest of the world ceases to exist. I have no idea where this will take me. All I know is that I love it. And wherever it takes me, I'm in for the ride, because so far it's been one exhilarating ride. Let's talk a little bit about the paintings now. All of the paintings are there in the e-catalog as well as listed on the website, along with the write-up and the image. While the e-catalog is easy to share, the paintings are probably better viewed on the website rather than on the catalog. There are, of course, far too many to go through in one evening, so I have picked a few to highlight, which also, in a way, serve to tell my story. So this one is called Dare to be Different. I thought I would start with this one because in some way, it's a reflection of my journey. There is a very famous dialogue in the movie Bunty or Bubbly, which Hemant always teases me with. It goes, ये जो वर्ल्ड है ना इसमें दो तरह के लोग होते हैं एक वो लोग जो सारी जिंदगी एक ही काम करते हैं और एक वो लोग जो एक ही जिंदगी में सारे काम करते हैं सो हेमंत थिंक्स ही बिलोंग्स टू द फॉर्मर एंड आई बिलोंग टू द लैटर एनीवे वी हैव अ लॉट ऑफ फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स इन आवर कम्युनिटी व्हिच इंक्लूड हिबिस्कस प्लांट्स ऑफ वेरियस कलर्स इंक्लूडिंग व्हाइट एंड पिंक वंस सो वन मॉर्निंग व्हेन हेमंत एंड आई वर ऑन आवर रेगुलर वॉक एज वी पास द हिबिस्कस प्लांट्स We saw this one flower, half pink and half white, standing out, totally unique and different. I walked past that spot many times since and never again seen a flower like that. So, how do I decide what to paint? The inspiration from my paintings comes from various things. Sometimes it may be from everyday things, which I have now learned to observe, appreciate, and enjoy more keenly. Like a flower that I might see on my walk, or it could be an interesting tree, or it could be the color of the sky or the pattern of clouds. Sometimes it's from photos and experiences shared by friends, like this one. This one is called Harmony. This is Karla Caves, which is painted from a photo shared by my friend, Dr. Richa Jagtap from Mumbai, who's an avid photographer. This one is called Ek Titli. Anek Titliya. This was painted from a photo shared by my friend and neighbor Janki on our building WhatsApp group, which incidentally is also called Titliya. It captures the phenomena of butterfly migration, which we were of the blue, this is the blue tiger butterfly, and we were fortunate enough to witness this in our community a few months ago. This next one is called Veiled in Mystery. Many of you may remember Sudipta Sen, who used to be a Rotarian in our club before she relocated to England. This was a photo taken by Mahesh, which Sudipta had shared on Facebook, which I have used as a reference for painting this, with her permission, of course. Sometimes inspiration can come from places that we have traveled to and photos taken on those trips. Travel has been a great shared passion between Hemant and me, and we have been fortunate enough to have visited 6 continents so far. So this was painted from photos taken on our trip to Vietnam in April 2019, and it shows Hoi An, which is a city in central Vietnam, is the historic district, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And it's a very quaint and charming place with the houses with these characteristic mustard walls and red lanterns everywhere. And the riverfront in Hoi An, if you see it in the evening when all the red lights, lanterns are lit, has a very, almost a magical feel to it. 2020 and the pandemic. What a year it has been for the whole world. So how could it be that such a year, crazy year that we have lived with, which is going to leave such a large world footprint in human history, it was not possible that it would not be chronicled in my painting story. But pandemic or no pandemic, there are many people who never show their real face to the world, many masks that they wear, and now we have one more mask to wear on top of that. Be that as it may, wear a mask, stay safe. This one is called Be the Light. In these dark and difficult times, be the light within. Sometimes paintings don't necessarily come from things or places. They could be a thought or an emotion in my head which finds visual representation. Last year, I have had several moments of frustration, fatigue, and despair where everything has seemed dark and difficult. And in such moments, it's important to find the light within. Sometimes paintings may come from a song that I'm humming or just something that's playing on my playlist. In my catalog, you'll find that a lot of my paintings have song captions. Sometimes it can be the painting that brings a song to mind. Sometimes it can be the other way around and a song that brings a painting to mind. Music has been one of my other enduring passions, as many of you know. So how could music not be a part of my art? So this next three paintings are inspired by my Tumri playlist, which I was listening to one day. This was the idea sparked from a song by called Khamaj by Fuzon. I was listening to it as I was going through some old photographs of a weekend trip to Ajmer and Jaipur, trying to look for something to paint. So when I heard the words, aiso gayo pardes piya tum chain hame nahi aaye nain tihari raah nihare nainan ko tarsao na, this was the visual that came to my mind. She is waiting for her beloved. Every day she looks at the road that will bring him home, but he's not yet come. The wait intensifies. She's still waiting. She laments, aaye na balam ka karu sajni, khoj rahi hai piya pardesi akhiya, aaye na balam. He's still not come. What shall I do? My eyes are looking for him everywhere. But the story couldn't just end there, could it? So after what seems like waiting forever, the wait is finally over. He's at the door, but hold on. She's not ready. She doesn't want to rush this moment. She wants to draw out the anticipation. She wants to dress up, adorn herself. And when she's ready, she'll ever so slowly open the door for him. Thaade rahiyo, o baake yaar re, thaade rahiyo. Sometimes some of my paintings come from just old photographs which I find when I'm scanning my gallery, which I've almost forgotten about and stumble upon them accidentally, like this one, which is from one of our many walks and treks which have been such an integral part of our vacations. Last year has been quite difficult being stuck at home. I've been missing travel, missing the outdoors, and missing all these walks in the woods. So this was painted in a moment of longing for a return to those times. Hopefully, it shall not be too far away. Until then, we soldier on uphill, one step at a time. The reference for this painting was, this is Auraki or Mount Cook, as it's locally known in New Zealand. The reference for this painting was a photo taken from our visit to New Zealand in 2002, which is almost more than 18 years ago. As I mentioned, there have been no new places to go to, no new photos to take. So I've been scrolling through old hard disks, trying to look for things to paint. Sometimes you stumble upon a photo where there's an instant connect with the mood and emotion of the picture. So this was one such photo which instantly brought to my mind the optimism of a new dawn after a dark night and a difficult climb, which is what last year has felt like, and hopefully 2021 is the new dawn with happier tidings. This one is called Making Waves, and making waves is what I hope we can do with this new project. So as you can see, my paintings are not confined to one subject or theme or style or color palette. Not yet anyway, maybe never. I just paint whatever resonates with me in that moment. I have many interests and my painting is an amalgamation of all those interests, basically a reflection of me. It's my journey into discovering myself, and I don't want to try and fit that into any box. Today is just a beginning. There's a long road ahead and a lot of work to be done. So I would like to end with this one, quoting Robert Frost. The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep and miles to go before I sleep. Thank you.
Thank you, Biraj, for sharing this lovely journey of yours from a doctor to a musician to an artist. If I have more than the words, the shine on your face said what a lovely experience you've had. You've enjoyed every moment. I now call on Rotarian Vinod John to make some announcement on the sale of paintings which are being displayed here and which are also on the website.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, I think we owe another big round of applause to Ann Biraj Kalyan. Not just for a talk, it's the effort that she's put into the painting, and all that effort has gone into BCRT. I must say, we planned this for the last 1 month. We actually wanted to open the painting today, but we decided let's do a pre-booking kind of thing. And I'm so happy to say that close to 20 paintings have already been sold by the pre-booking. I just want to quickly acknowledge the donors who have contributed to BCRT through this painting. Anjali Sridhar, Dr. Maya Nayak, who picked up 2 paintings, Hari Krishna, Meera Bell, Mercy John, Preeti Dodi, Radhi, Radhika Pai, Rajalakshmi, Rekha Shivdev, Shabir, Shakti Kumar, who picked up 2 paintings, Shashi Nandakumar, Sheila Ramesh, Sudha Timaya, Sudhakar, Sushila, and TV Mohan. Thank you all. Thank you, wonderful. Arvind's name is not here. Arvind Gokhale also. I didn't find his name here. Arvind, thank you so much. Thank you all for the contribution. Thank you all for kicking off this initiative. There's one more thing I want to bring to a fact out here. There's Anne Kavita Venkatesh, who's also a painter, has quietly sold 9 paintings and contributed 55,000 to the BCRT already. Here's a fact. I think there's a whole lot of talented Anns in our own club. And I believe there are many more painters, hidden talent out there. Let's all come together. We are going through a very difficult year. This year, Ravi and team has had a struggle in terms of the funding for BCRT. We are not able to fund our projects. We are eating out of our corpus. We can't go on like this many years. Next year, again, we haven't started the fundraising yet. We hope to have on Golfity. We don't know how it will go. We need more than 50 lakhs every year to run, sustain the current projects. And the money has to come through some fundraising. And this is just a beginning. Let us all get together. One great initiative, Project She, that we all kicked off right now. Let the ants bring out whatever you can. We will create a platform for you to sell, do whatever you want. Every rupee matters. So let's come up with innovative ideas, creative ideas, build some. This is just a fantastic beginning we had through and Biraj Kalyan and Kavita Venkatesh. I'm hoping to see a lot more such initiatives. And the sale is now on. We have 30 more of these paintings left. I think each one of us should pick up a few of those paintings, even if to give somebody. Remember, each rupee that you contribute is going towards educating a girl child. Thank you all. Thank you all once again.
Hello. Thank you, Vinod. I think you set the ball rolling and you set the tone also for this momentous occasion, initiative. Only 30 more to go, and I'm sure by very soon all these paintings will also be sold. May now request Ann Preeti Anniversary Dodi to please come up and propose a vote of thanks.
One feels so small in the midst of so much of a profusion of talent here. Thank you, ma'am, Mrs. Rekha Rao, for gracing this occasion. It is such an honor to have you here, a person who is so multifaceted, versatile, accomplished, and in many ways, you know, so, so giving, charitable, and philanthropic. Thank you for being with us. We really, really salute the work that you do for humanity. Thank you for all the good advice and the wise counsel that you have shared with us. Coming to our own Veeraj Kalyan, I run out of superlatives to describe this Anne. Writer par excellence, every story around the painting has so much to tell you. Endearing stories, stories that actually steal your heart. Musician, every Anne's night has Veeraj on the stage, saving the show for us. Yes, painter, the display is all for you to see. Doctor in every capacity, as she has spoken about. Excellent cook. Yes, we all remember the lunches and dinners and the crowd that we have at Veeraj's house. Mother, daughter-in-law, wife, philanthropist, and I can go on. The list is endless. Thank you for your contribution, Veeraj. Always appreciate all that you have to do for Rotary. You inspire each one of us to think and start wondering what is it that we can do from our side now that you know you have started us on this journey. Thank you, Kavita, another of our aunts, artist, businesswoman, painter, great cook. Thank you for your paintings. All of them emote so many experiences that it is amazing. Yes, and thank you, Rotary, for this occasion, Vinod, and everyone else here. I would also take this opportunity to thank the entire team that put together this particular project of She. And to start with, it is Vinod, Nanda, Sushila, Bharat, Hemant, and Murthy for helping out in displaying everything over here and keeping things so spotlessly clean and very well displayed. Thank you so much, and thank you for being here, all of you.
Thank you, Preeti, for letting the cat out of the bag. May I ask Indrani to come up and give a rose to our speaker and to Veeraj and the other hands. I don't know whether Indrani can come up. Let me take the pleasure of going down. We have a problem climbing. Come, Veeraj. Please accept a rose. Yeah. Yes, be here. We saw the one with the mask. Yeah, no, we saw the painting with the mask. So I remember this song there. Kahi chehre pe. May I invite the rest of the aunts to come up and, oh, you want to take it, then go, please. But somebody has to carry this one. Won't be able to carry. The cannula in your hand. Yeah, no, no, just a minute. Thank you once again, Vinod, for kicking off this wonderful fundraising. I'm sure we can have more such opportunities to do more paintings on a larger scale.